Ki hei Māori ora. Whakarongoa keu ki te manu nei te mā tuia. Tuia ki runga, tuia ki raro. Tuia ki waho, tuia ki roto. Tuia te here tangata kārongo te kō, kārongo te ao. Tui tuia i roto i ngā kaupapa. Tui tuia te tai ao, o Aotearoa. E ngā mana, e ngā reo, e ngā waka katoa ko tau mai nei. Hare mai, hare mai, piki mai, kake mai. Hare mai rā ki tēne o ngā wānanga. Kia rongo i ngā pūkenga, kia rongo rā i ngā kōrero, o tēnei tūranga o te taiao. Ngā mihi kia koutou, mai ano i ngā maunga o Waitākere ki tī ki te rangi. Mai ano i ngā moana taku o te mānukunuka o te roa, o te Waitemata. Me ngā awa e rere nei, o te mihi kia koutou, piki mai, kake mai. Ki te mana whenua o Ngāti Pārua, te Waiohua, te Kawerewa Mati. Ko rātou, tu sunu, i roto i te rangatira taku. Rātou kia rātou. Te tini ngā tini aitua kei Waianui a tātou, haere rātou. Tātou rā te hunga ora, ki nā koutou, ki nā koutou. Ki ngā manu hiri, tu ārangi. Ki nā rā kourua. Kei te haere mai, ki te kōrero, ki ngā kai te roto i ngā kete. Ki te whānai rā, i o mātou i tari. Ka mihi, kia kōrua, haere mai. Not in translation, but I will explain my mihi. I first related to the tui bird, a bird that has a special purpose in the forest of gathering together what is happening in the forest. And the name for sowing is tui, tui tuia, bringing it all together. I acknowledge this place that we stand in, and I acknowledge the mana whenua of Ngāti Pātua, te Kawerewa Mati, te Waiohua. I acknowledge each and every one of you from the many cultures, our distinguished leaders, members and staff, and also our leaders in the Auckland Council. As I acknowledge you, I also acknowledge our loved ones that are not with us today. And we share those in our memories of those who have gone before us. But in this particular instance, those pioneers that made the way for you and I to be here today in caring for this environment. I use the words ngā kete, e whāngai nei ngā kete. We are but caretakers, we are kaitiaki of this environment. And kaitiaki carries a lot of responsibility. And it is my responsibility to make sure that this place is in good state for my mokopuna and their mokopuna. And I'm so looking forward to listening to our distinguished guests and our guest speakers this afternoon. So, tēnā koutou, on behalf of the mana whenua, I would like to say welcome to this forum today, to this conference, and also welcome to our special guest. Tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, kia ora mai rā tātou.
Thank you, Bobby. Good evening. For those of you I haven't met, my name is Gail Ogilvie, and I am currently the Manager of Environmental Services at Auckland Council. In that role, I have the privilege of leading a team of committed scientists, engineers, and community engagement specialists dedicated to improving Auckland's environment. In this capacity this evening, I am honoured to welcome you here, following up from Bobby's address, and also give some few introductory comments and provide some background to our guest speakers. I've worked as an environmental practitioner all my working life, which is coming up actually to a shockingly long 30 years. Reflecting back on those three decades between 1983 and 2013, just about every measure of environmental quality, from carbon dioxide levels in our atmosphere to water quality in our fresh and marine receiving environments,
to the abundance and diversity of our native flora and fauna, is going backwards, and in most cases, at an accelerating rate. We need a game changer. Collectively, as New Zealand's environmental sector, we have not motivated the bulk of New Zealand citizens to understand and care about our rapidly declining environment, and most importantly, do something about it. At the risk of overstating and oversimplifying the situation, we have consoled and supported each other with a shared sense of what's at stake, and in the process, marginalised ourselves from mainstream New Zealand. We need a game changer. I believe that we need to move beyond the trade-off situation we seem locked into, environmental protection versus economic development. In this situation, the environment loses. How could it be otherwise? New Zealanders balancing what, in their view, is a highly technical and therefore, in some cases, not well understood plea to protect what appears to be in perfectly good condition in comparison to many other places in the world, versus more jobs for their families and economic growth. I've actually had some recent experiences of that trade-off. I'm relatively new to Auckland Council. I've been with the organisation for coming up to a year and a half now. And I was involved at the periphery with the development of the unitary plan. I'm on the operational side of council. The bulk of the unitary plan was developed in the planning strategy areas of Auckland Council. Now, I don't know the detail, but I am an optimist, and I'm hopeful that the bulk of that new set of rules for Auckland takes account of the value of our environment. I was, however, involved in some conversations with the scribes for that plan. They had this concept of where things land, and this illustrates the trade-off. Where things land was a bit of a euphemism for what the developers were seeking as part of the rule book and what made sense with respect to environmental protection. So in many of the myriad of decisions that were being made in the lead up to the development of that rule book, there was this trade-off occurring on a constant basis. And as I said, I don't know the detail. I was involved in some of those trade-off decisions only. So the game changer is to eliminate the trade-off, to eliminate the concept that the environment is a luxury, nice to have option, to be replaced with an understanding that a healthy environment is a precursor to the world's most livable city. The benefits and value of a healthy environment we could all list in this room: green jobs, ecotourism, amenity, human health, improved recreational opportunities. We need to define the environment as an asset, manage it as an asset with tangible economic value. One of the directives in the Auckland plan, which is, I spoke about the unitary plan, which as many of you will be aware is the rule book. The Auckland plan is utopia in 30 years. The challenge, of course, is working out the roadmap towards that utopia. What do we need to do in the next 5 years after that? The unitary plan, the Auckland plan has a directive, Directive 7.1. Directive 7.1 of Auckland's vision over a 30-year horizon is to integrate ecosystem services into decision-making. So that's to integrate the concept that we're here to talk about tonight, and I'm really pleased to see such a great turn-up because this is such an essentially important topic as a core mechanism for getting us beyond this trade-off situation which is not working for us and has never been working for us. So we have a directive in the Auckland plan to integrate ecosystem services into decision making. And actually it's a fledgling working group, but we do have a fledgling working group headed by Karen Kriag, who is here this evening, working on that within Auckland Council, looking at the decisions we're currently making and comparing those decisions that we're making at the moment with how those decisions would look if we were able to take account of ecosystem services, so the value that nature's providing us. So we're extremely fortunate this evening. I'm really looking forward to the presentations and the discussion from our guest speakers, who many of you will know well in terms of name only, if not having met personally, those of you who have worked in this area. And I will introduce both the speakers together, and then my understanding is that both speakers will come up and have a conversation about this important topic. So we have with us this evening Dr. Robert Costanza. Now, Robert is a name, as I mentioned, you're probably all familiar with. He is currently the professor and chair in public policy at the Crawford School of Public Policy at the Australian National University. Prior to this, he was distinguished university professor of sustainability in the Institute for Sustainable Solutions at Portland State University. He was a professor of ecological economics and founding director of the Gund Institute for Ecological Economics at the University of Vermont. He is co-founder of the International Society for Ecological Economics and founding editor-in-chief of the journal Solutions. He'll be joined up on the stage by Associate Professor Marianne Vanderbilt. Marianne is Director and Associate Professor of Ecological Economics Research in New Zealand at Massey University. Marianne is an ecological economist and science leader on MBIE-funded Sustainable Pathways 2, which I'm sure we'll hear something about. Her research focuses on urban spatial planning, ecosystem service valuation, investing in natural capital, and associated tools to foster collaborative research and adaptive management among stakeholders across multi-scales. So I'm really looking forward to hearing these presentations, and I'm really looking forward to working with the individuals in this room and broader Auckland society to shift from a trade-off situation, which has just not been working, from an environmental outcomes perspective, to a situation where we can all more adequately value our natural assets and use that valuation in our decision making. So I'd like to welcome Marianne and Robert to the stage. Thank you.
That one? Hi, everyone.
Tēnā kātou, katoa.
First of all, thanks for having us. Thank you, Auckland Council, especially Karen, Craig, for the invitation and having us here. We wanted to start up first and take a little bit of a stock of who we have in this room, because this is literally a conversation. We will first have a conversation among ourselves for a couple of minutes, and then we'll invite questions from you. And so the type of questions that you ask will determine what we can convey to you. So first want to test if these hands actually work. So how many people have heard of ecological economics?
Oh, right.
Okay, we can briefly go over that. Ecosystem services.
Excellent.
Excellent. Council people.
Whoa.
Good. Okay, this was a great excuse not to be on the other side of the road, I suppose. People from academia? Oh, a few. Business? NGOs? All right. Yeah, pretty good. So, other.
Yes. Residents.
Okay.
35,000 live in the CBD and 15,000 rental units.
There we go. The residents. We've got them in the room too. Good. Yes, a few. Let's get started. I think we should move on and ask Bob to give an overview of ecological economics and ecosystem services.
Thank you. And it sounds like you're all up to speed, at least to a certain extent, with what those two concepts are. So I won't spend too much time on that, but maybe just pick up on what Gail was saying. And that is that I think ecological economics and ecosystem services can be a real game changer. It's really a different vision of how we conceive of the relationship between humans and what I like to call the rest of nature, recognizing that we are all in this together. So it gets beyond the environment is separate from the economy, that the economy is independent of the rest of nature, and recognizes that the vision, the more accurate vision of the relationship is, the economy embedded in society, embedded in the rest of the natural world. It's a very different vision, I think, from the one that drives a lot of policy making and decision making, unfortunately, still. But I think it is getting a lot more traction these days. Once you change that vision, then I think it changes a lot of things too about how we study that relationship, our academic sort of arrangements, and requires us to get out of the disciplinary silos and start to look at the whole system in a much more interdisciplinary, I would go beyond that and say transdisciplinary way. So ecological economics from its inception was intended to be a transdisciplinary field that integrates the study of humans and the rest of nature. I call it ecological economics. Those are sort of the main two existing disciplines that we thought needed to be integrated, and we thought economics needed a lot more help than ecology did in terms of that integration. So that's why we sort of put the ecological first. But it could go a number of different ways, and you could change that title as well and broaden it to include, sociology and political science and everything else. It's really an effort to look at the world in a much more integrated way, in a much longer term way, both historically and into the future, and to develop policies that can really help us achieve what I think our shared goals should be, and maybe we could have a show of hands there, but our shared goals as a society should be sustainability and a high quality of life that's sustainable, that's shared and sustainable. The conventional economic paradigm is far too narrow in that regard and focuses far too much on just one aspect of that, the built capital infrastructure, the stuff that is circulating in markets, the stuff that's picked up in GDP. And we know from a lot of other research that doesn't really improve well-being beyond a certain point. The things like the genuine progress indicator show that if you start incorporating the external costs of GDP growth in many countries beyond a certain point, things start to level off and even go negative. We're in a period of uneconomic growth now, if you take a more comprehensive measure. So ecosystem services obviously are an important part of that, recognizing the contributions of natural capital, our natural assets of the environment, to human well-being and its sustainability. And that's what we're trying to value. We're trying to estimate in one way or another, what is that contribution? And it's a relative contribution because it's in combination with the other major types of assets that we have, our built capital assets, our social capital, all of our interactions among each other and institutions, and you know, the market itself is a form of social capital, and our human capital, our individual health and education and bodies. So it's inherently transdisciplinary in that way. You cannot understand sustainable human well-being without understanding the joint contribution of all of those major types of assets. And just kick me when I'm gone on too long, but so, and I know you guys probably already know most of this, so I'm just reiterating and re-emphasizing that we can really, I think, change the game if we start changing the way we frame these arguments and changing the way we conceive of our relationship to the rest of nature. I'll just give you one quick example of how that has happened that I know about. In Costa Rica, I know they have this payment for ecosystem services system. And the story I was told by the environment minister who implemented this was that, you know, he would go into the cabinet meetings as environment minister and he would say, we're losing all our forests, the water's getting polluted and blah, blah, blah. And they would say, okay, next item. And so he wasn't getting any traction out of this. The story he told me, I'm not sure if this is true, but he said he read our 1997 paper about the value of ecosystem services. He went into the cabinet meeting and said, look, all of our ecosystems are producing this much value, you know, and put it in monetary units. And they said, ah, okay, we got to do something about that. And so they implemented this payment for ecosystem service system, which has allowed them to reforest essentially a large fraction of the country that was deforested for cattle ranching. So it can, I think, make a huge difference in real policy decisions. And we could give lots of other examples. And I think, Marianne, maybe you could give some examples more locally.
I can. I just wanted to add, emphasize that the transdisciplinary aspect really is when you look at a thing differently, the thing itself actually changes. So it's the way you look at something. So when you look at economics differently, then it changes and it becomes ecological economics. And when you look at prices differently, then it becomes, the conversation becomes about values rather than prices. And when you look at problems in a different way, then they become solutions. So the focus of what we're having here is really, okay, there are problems. How can we turn those challenges into solutions? How do we do that? And I think we have a few tools to share with you to show how that can be done. Ecosystem services then, I think that was when we worked on the Nature paper, that was right about the time, and it's one of these sort of moments in time when things changed. It really became a paradigm shift in that before that we had focused on mitigation and trying to solve things that were wrong and putting the finger at people, we can't do this, can't do that. And why ecosystem services became a paradigm shift was it became a strength-based thing to do. So suddenly there were these benefits, as Bob was saying, and suddenly, you know, it was exciting to work on the environment again. It's like when you're slightly overweight and you want to lose weight, and people have a focus on losing that weight. That's a problem. That's not a particularly interesting thing to do. It's actually quite of a burden.
Or fun.
Right. Far more result do people get when they start focusing on their health, on their overall health, rather than on weight loss. And it's the same with this ecosystem services approach. It's a strength-based approach.
Maybe one confusion that has arisen that we should probably address is that when we talk about valuing ecosystem services, we're not talking about pricing them, privatizing them, exchanging them, you know, in markets necessarily. That's part of the whole point, is that these are generally common assets. They are difficult, if not impossible, or at least shouldn't be privatized. But that doesn't mean we shouldn't and don't value them. We value these services all the time and these systems all the time because we make decisions about how we use them, and that implicitly reveals a value. So we should be more upfront about trying to value their contribution to human well-being, but we shouldn't necessarily
put them up for sale,
yeah. You know, privatize them. So there are other kinds of institutions. The system in Costa Rica, for example, was kind of a quasi government agency that was set up to collect fees from water users and tourists and use that to pay private landowners to change their behavior. But I think the point of that is as Bobby was saying in his introduction, that you know, we need to think of ourselves more as caretakers, as stewards, as trustees, you know, over these ecosystems. And some institutions like common asset trusts think of the ecosystem as a common asset that can't be left as an open access resource, as we are now doing with the atmosphere, with the oceans, and many other things. But also shouldn't be privatized. But we can assign property rights to those resources on behalf of the whole community. So we can make them a common asset with the appropriate rights and regulations. Eleanor Ostrom won the Nobel Prize in economics a couple years ago for her work on common assets and how they're managed in traditional cultures and the characteristics that are required to make that work. So the tragedy of the commons, which is really the tragedy of open access resources, can be overcome with the appropriate kinds of institutions. And I think our challenge is to modernize, to bring into the modern world some of those lessons and develop new kinds of institutions that can better manage whole ecosystems for the whole range of services that they provide, both for the current and future generations.
Okay, so we agree that putting a price like we did in 97 was really a conversation starter. And when we have the attention, that's it. Then we want to continue that conversation, that game-changing conversation about what do those values mean, where do they come from, what do they mean locally, what are they derived from, what is producing those values. And then it very much becomes about the natural capital, and natural capital is, you know, your forests, your wetlands, your coastal zones, marines, all those ecosystems from which we derive ecosystem services such as flood protection, food, pollination, climate regulation, all those things that are desirable. So put a value on it and then start the conversation. How does that system look? So we've done that in for example, the Manawatu, where I'm currently based. In 2009, we took the basic benefit transfer approach from that paper in Nature, and we said, okay, let's do this now for the Manawatu. And the same thing pretty much happened. A lot of value came out of it. And then they said, that's interesting, now let's talk about that. What does that mean? So we did something called mediated modeling. So we had a group of stakeholders, about 20 of them, in the room and started talking about the system and the type of issues that we saw there, and the natural capital that was present in that area, and then also the ecosystem services. And we try to link that into a dynamic system. Where is that going to go over time? And based on that, come up with some actions, what we could possibly be doing about that. That was an interesting conversation. You can find the results on our website. I have to say that conversation went only so far, and then it was politics. And I'm sure everybody sits here and says, yeah, these ideas are all very nice. And then there is politics. Yes, and I always see half of the room nodding. I think I should basically continue a little bit, and then we should leave this to the questions. The only other thing I would like to add is that based on the modeling that we did do with people, We then had an opportunity to put this in a more spatially explicit framework and said, because people were interested not only how things changed over time, they were also interested in where what happened in their region. So we had to accommodate that as well. And then it becomes a conversation about how do you bring a lot of data, a lot of GIS information together with very localized pieces of information into a system that people start understanding. So you can start to show a map of an area and say, if we invest here, then we get revenue over a certain time that shows up somewhere else in the region. Because some of these ecosystem services are very local, some of them are very regional, and others are global. And so the ecosystem services approach, especially the spatial and the time aspect of it, allows you to connect the local with the regional, with the national, with the global. And that makes it quite powerful. That makes it an opportunity to tie together the landscapes that we have here. So the urban area, see that as an ecosystem, as a catchment, really. And tie it in with the marine system and the coastal system. Tie it in with the backlands. And find the metric that allows these areas to talk with each other and set up the type of institutions that Bob was talking about. If there is ecosystem services that are received, say, an urban area, we might want to pay a farmer upstream to deliver those ecosystem services. Yeah, maybe I should stop here and leave it to you for some other great ideas.
Yeah, no, I think that's a critical part of it, is and to bring it all back to the implications for quality of life and sustainability and livability, if you want to put it in those terms. But I think that's really what we're all after. It's not so much generating more and more stuff. It's generating a higher quality of life. And you know, there are several examples you could point to, including you know, our individual bodies. You don't want to just keep eating and eating and growing and growing. At some point, you want to grow up to a certain point, but all biological systems need to level off and then start working on quality and making things better. So I think we're at that stage now where we need to make that fundamental shift from quantity to quality. You know, at the global scale, but also at many other scales. Now, there are certainly some parts of the world that need additional growth in the conventional way, but I think even that needs to be more balanced development. Our conventional approach to growth has been very unequally distributed, and that has a direct influence on quality of life, in addition to the implications for the natural capital depletion that goes on. So all of those elements, you know, have to be thought of in a much more integrated and more balanced way if we really want to achieve that shared goal of a sustainable, high quality of life that's equitably distributed. That seems to be what the vision of the Auckland plan sort of has as its basis as well. And I think there are many other cities that are doing similar things. I was living in Portland, Oregon most recently, and they certainly have that very directly as their development goals. Their department of there's a department of sustainability and planning. They sort of merge them, so they're not separate departments. And they certainly are doing a lot of good things, and you probably have know about some of the things they're doing and can use some of their examples. I should also mention that this whole idea of ecosystem services, I think, has really started to catch on. You know, it took a number of years, but now there are many initiatives at different levels that you may or may not have heard of. For example, there's the IPBES, the Intergovernmental Panel on Biodiversity and Ecosystem Services. So it's the equivalent of the IPCC, but now on the specifically devoted to ecosystem
change.
Services. Pardon?
That's on climate change.
IPCC is the climate change equivalent. You probably know what the IPCC is, but this is the new one. There's a project called TEEB, the Economics of Ecosystems and Biodiversity, that was funded by the Deutsche Bank and UNEP. So there's a program at the World Bank called WAVES, the Wealth Accounting and Valuation of Ecosystem Services. I know the Australian Bureau of Statistics is now trying to integrate ecosystem services into their national accounting. There's a group called the Ecosystem Services Partnership that's trying to integrate all of this, you know, literally, I would say, thousands of individuals and groups around the world that are now working on this, and I'm sure some of them are here in the room today. So there is there is progress being made, and I think things are shifting. So this is really a good time to implement Directive 7.1.
It's going to be interesting to see how we're going to do that. There has been a flurry of use of ecosystem services, and we did a literature review recently for New Zealand on ecosystem services, especially for agriculture, to see how this term was used. And we found on the very strict rules for this search, 44 articles. And then we looked a little closer on, articles that used ecosystem services. And sometimes that was a whole article about worms, that worms produced compost, and it was great. And then at the end it was mentioned, and that's an ecosystem service, soil formation. Well, it's great that, the term gets picked up and that we are starting to see that soil formation is indeed an ecosystem service. Most of these papers didn't define what an ecosystem service was. So we have a big task ahead of us, even though there's a lot of noise around ecosystem services. How are we going to really use this as an organizing principle? There's lots and lots of different ecosystem services projects in New Zealand and everywhere in the world. United Nations has a good program. I really don't want people to miss out on that one. The system of environment economic accounting. That, to me, could really start complementing the need to account for GDP, for example. The Auckland Plan, when we started with sustainable pathways a few years back, the Auckland Plan was just coming into existence, and it did have this wonderful, I don't know if you've ever seen that, this sort of spider diagram with these four areas, which were basically the four capitals, right? And then it had all these work trails off into these areas in natural capital and social capital and human capital, how are we going to educate people? But they were all individual strands. And so the task was right in front of us. How are you going to connect these work streams around those four capitals? How do you do that? What kind of skills? Then you need a whole different set of skills in a council that wants to integrate to do that well. And do we, in academia and schools, do we train people with the right skills to synthesize? Usually we train people to analyze, to go into a particular topic, and it's reflected in the work streams. So what kind of skills do we need to train people with, and do we need to train in schools from very early on to have more of that systems thinking in their heads? I call systems thinking an uncommon common sense. Everybody knows about it, we know things are interconnected, but to train the discipline to think through systems in a productive way and to have systems thinking as your basic framework and mechanism to frame a dialogue about, rather than a linear, list of things to tick off, that's a whole different skill. And I see Bobby not there. And it's actually, we work a lot with Maori communities, and they get this. Life is like, yeah, clearly, things are integrated. And if you then allow the space, it's basically about creating the space for these conversations to happen, right? However they want to happen, they happen. But to have the mechanism to start connecting the dots and to allow the dialogues to flow the way they need to flow is very, very powerful. And the iwi communities which I work are fairly open to that. And that's when the real value is brought forward. And so where the council would want to see a time frame, the iwi will see a process. A certain process has to be followed in order to come to an outcome rather than, an actual time frame. And New Zealand is just a wonderful place to work because of that cultural diversity. It's the main reason why I came here, actually, to work on this.
We should also mention, I think, the importance of a vision in achieving real change in these systems. That, as the famous American philosopher Yogi Berra once said, if you don't know where you're going, you end up somewhere else. So you have to know where you're going. I think that's part of the idea behind things like the Auckland plan. But I think we need to build that shared vision, you know, at other scales, at many scales, including the national and the global scale. What do we really? What kind of world do we really want? You know, what does sustainability and desirability mean in a future world? So I think that conversation is something that we don't have enough of. To me, it's really the essence of what democracy should be all about. You know, coming to some broad consensus about what kind of goals we're trying to achieve. And I think the rest of it is technical. But that's the part that really requires broad consensus. And Marianne, you have a vision.
Are we already ready for the vision?
Yeah.
Well, I think we should talk also a little bit about scenario planning, for example, as one of those tools.
For envisioning, yeah.
From envisioning comes things like scenario planning, and those are quite powerful tools, again, in the ecological economics toolbox. But if you think it's time for the vision, sure. I'll do the vision.
Well, we wanted to leave as much time as possible for a real dialogue with the
audience.
Yeah, no,
that's
absolutely
correct. No, this is a vision that I put together in July. I was put in a conference, Valuing Nature. Who went to Valuing Nature in Wellington? Ah, yeah, good. It was a powerful event, eh? Yeah. And Pavan Sukhdev did a great, the TEEP leader, did a great presentation for about an hour. And then I was up. What are you going to say after Pavan Sukhdev? That could add value. I mean, there was not a whole lot. Other than that, I could come up with my own vision, because a vision is mine, and it is my prerogative to share it with you or not. And I don't think we do enough of that. So since it has also been aired a few times on the radio NZ and all that, so I'm going to share this one with you. I hope that's okay with you. So in 100 years, New Zealand has recovered from the current period of uneconomic growth and is economically developing. We maintain natural capital base as an essential infrastructure. This ecological infrastructure has left us less vulnerable, but not immune to a changed climate. We use technology and economic activities to work with natural capital. And a lower dependency on financial capital has left New Zealand more resilient toward global financial upsets. New institutions, Common Asset Trust, have emerged that give voice to the integrity of common assets and take into account the voices of future generations. Cultural diversity is celebrated as a source of creativity, and return on investment is measured in the return on natural, social, human, as well as built and financial capital. The ability to engage with complex challenges in a collaborative way is leading to innovation in unforeseen ways. We have created institutions that provide meaningful employment with activities that stay within the ecological carrying capacity. We are global citizens, and other countries, especially island nations, find the New Zealand model inspirational. The CEO of New Zealand is evaluated on how she maintains the common assets, how we live off the interest of our natural capital rather than eating into our asset base. Now, this vision is inspirational to some, and other people find it terrifying and downright annoying, because we've got problems to solve. Now, a vision is not judged by its implementation pathway. It's judged by its clarity and how it inspires people. And from a vision, you can then backcast and say, just like you're doing here in Auckland, how did we get there? What did we need to do in 50 years from now, 20 years from now, 10 years from now? What do we need to do right today to be consistent with going in this direction? I think it's encouraging that we have the Hauraki Gulf marine spatial planning activities going on. Auckland has urban spatial planning going on. Waikato, rural spatial planning. Why not stitch all these pieces together? Why not really do this for New Zealand as well as for the regions, including Auckland, because we have to address this at multiple scales. So again, I leave you to ponder. When you look at a thing differently, the thing itself changes. And we look forward to your questions.
Yeah, Thanks.
Good afternoon, everyone. Everyone can hear okay? I'm Damon Birchfield. I'm a senior strategic advisor here in the Auckland Council and the Environmental Services Unit, and I have the privilege this afternoon of leading your Q&A session. And I guess I'd quite like to encourage everyone to take this opportunity to think of some good, tough questions for our distinguished guests and really interrogate some of the concepts which you know they've been sharing us with us this afternoon. I'd like to get the ball rolling, if I may. I mean, it all sounds great, but I mean, does the ecological economic sort of have you concluded actually, or come up with a way that you can transition from this from very growth focused economy and economic model to this sort of more holistic way of valuing? And if so, why is it taking so long to get there? Because surely everyone wants and would understand the need and want to preserve the environment. So,
it's amazing that question always comes up. This all makes perfect sense, so why aren't we already doing it? And one way of looking at it is maybe to think of this as a form of addiction. You know, we're sort of locked in to the current system because it's all self-reinforcing and it's all, you know, it's a very tight regime. And so it's not surprising that it's difficult to change. It's difficult to break out of an addiction. One thing I've been thinking about is, you know, trying to relate this to how successful, you know, how people get out of individual addictions. What sort of therapy is really the most beneficial to breaking addictions? And the people who do this say that, you know, the worst thing you can do with an addict is to tell them, you know, you're in bad shape, there's a big problem, and you just got to stop doing what you're doing and just, you know, stop smoking, stop drinking, stop taking drugs, whatever it is. That immediately gets a defensive denial, you know, reaction. No, it's not a problem, I can handle it, you know, no big deal. It's exactly the reaction that we're getting from society with the way we've been framing, you know, the environmental issue, the climate issues, et cetera. So I think what ecological economics can bring to the table in ecosystem services is to reframe that as a positive vision. Say there is a better world that we can achieve. That's what tends to work with addicts as well. To have a conversation, say, you know, your life can be better. It's not a sacrifice to give up this addiction. It's really a sacrifice to keep on going with it. And it's still not going to happen overnight. I mean, there is a certain therapy that's going to be required, and it will take time. But I think these kinds of transitions often also happen as you know, at tipping points. They're not smooth, gradual transitions where things just keep changing gradually. It's, you know, things are building up below the surface. It doesn't look like anything's really changing though, because we're still locked into the current regime. And it's not until there's really a major regime shift, a major tipping point occurs. How does that process happen? There are some theories. There's this whole idea of cultural evolution and how cultures evolve in ways that are analogous to biological evolution. And they also change in the sort of tipping point kind of ways. And you can point to some evidence that, you know, our culture is changing. The idea of ecosystem services is getting more and more embedded into the different policies. And people's worldviews, I think, are changing also. So at some point, you know, that change in worldview, change in perception, change in framing will become dominant enough that the culture can shift, can flip. But it will probably happen seemingly overnight, and, you know, there will be some trigger that nobody can predict. You know, like the fall of the Soviet Union, for example, is an example. Does that answer your question?
So change creeps up.
Pardon?
Change creeps up.
It creeps up and then it happens quickly, I think.
We've got two roaming mics here. So I think, what's the idea, Susan, that you're going to circulate those? So, lady in green.
Hi, I'm Carol and I'm a resident and I'm working at the university as well. Thank you for your introduction. I'm having difficulty imagining how we activate some of what you're saying. So could you help us, perhaps people like me who are not experts in this field, to translate or to give us some concrete examples of what key ingredients take the vision of ecosystem that you've outlined to an actual example of perhaps a more livable city than Auckland. So what's an example of an ecosystem change, and what are the key ingredients that actually enabled that to happen, so that for those of us who are on the ground, we might think about what those ingredients might be here.
Yeah. Okay. You want to take that one?
I always get that hard one.
I can follow up, but go ahead.
I was sorry, I don't know who I talked to today. Wetlands in Auckland seem about as scarce as they are in the Manawatu. In the Manawatu, 98% of wetlands have disappeared. I heard a similar number of 96% or so in Auckland. Wetlands are your natural waste recycling plants. We can do it ourselves. We can put up great infrastructure and do it ourselves. But they are naturally doing that and doing that for free. 98% of them have disappeared. Granted, Manawatu used to be very swampy, and there was probably good reason to drain some of that. But 98%, perhaps that's a bit much. Now, what kind of ecosystem services do we get from that? We get storm protection. They act like sponges. Pollination, they're like habitat for pollinators. What else? Waste recycling, I already mentioned that. You can expand that, if you really look at it, all the way up to climate regulation. So I think those are the type of services that we have to make visible to people, that those wetlands are, in fact, more than an area that you convert in for food production and food production only. Does that make sense?
Yeah, but that's not quite what I'm asking. I'm asking how does a city that's been managed to move into that vision and enact it, what are the key ingredients that vision, I get that, but how does it work on the ground? I mean, how does it move into an activated thing that's made a city more livable?
Well, I could give maybe the example of Portland, Oregon, which has taken on board many of those ideas. I mean, they have a very well-protected watershed that's used for urban water supply. It's one of the few sort of untreated water supplies in the country, if not the world, that's still very high quality. They're very concerned about urban storm runoff and protection, and so all of the design features. It's a design element. A lot of this came about, because of a governor of Oregon back in the 70s, Tom McCall, who was a Republican, but he was very environmentally aware, and he implemented this whole sort of growth boundaries, sort of urban planning, to preserve the natural capital assets in the region. And they've tried to repeal those laws many times, but the public has stood behind it because they can see the impacts on their quality of life, and it does show up when you go there and walk around, and it's often ranked the most livable city in the country, if not the world.
Soon to be bumped off its pedestal. We've got a question at the back. Could we hear from the person? Well, Auckland hopes it's soon to be bumped off its pedestal anyway.
Ai, kia ora tātou.
Yeah.
Te mea tūtai ka mihi ki a koe, Bobby. Tō tātou kai arahi mo tēnei wehinga. Nō reira, tēnā koe. Ngā mihi koutou te tēpū, te ata mirira. So just acknowledging Bobby and yourselves, our discussion leaders, Robert and Marianne. My name is Dr. Kepa Morgan, teach here in engineering at the University of Auckland. So my question, really I want a discussion about this, but there's been a few strands come through in the dialogue so far. We started off talking about how the economic tends to dominate decision making, and that we need to position ecological considerations so that they can be more prominent in that decision process. So I like that idea, But I think that there's a danger when you frame those ecological services in the economic context. So to sort of reflect back what you said that we need to, I guess, not privilege money in terms of our decision making. So one of the fears I have with ecological economics is that by measuring these ecological services in economic terms, you continue to privilege money as the basis for the decision, and you make ecology a subset of the economy when we know fundamentally it's not that way around. So I just want you to discuss that, and then I want you to comment on whether maybe there is an alternative to money for measuring these things that are important. And there was a slide that was up there about 3 ago that said, what is the appropriate way of valuing our ecosystem? And so, righto, what is the appropriate way of valuing that if it's not money? Thank you.
Thanks for that question. I think that one comes up quite a bit too. And I think the answer there is that what you're really looking at is the relative contributions of these different assets to our well-being. And you can express those relative contributions in any of a number of units. The reason for using dollars is because that's a unit that is understood by a broad cross-section and often a part of the population that that really doesn't get the argument when expressed in other terms, if you know what I mean. But it's certainly not the only terms you could express those relative contributions in. You could use energy, you could use land, you could use time, you could use anything that is sort of one of the inputs as the common denominator. So a lot of it depends on which audience you're talking to, and some some audiences may prefer other units. But it's all really the same thing that you're talking about. That these things all contribute in relative ways to our well-being. And also, I don't think it's an either-or kind of question. Like either we value these things in monetary units, or we just think of them in sort of spiritual terms or ethical terms or whatever. It's not an either-or consideration. It's just we can do both of those things, and they just sort of mutually support each other. I think we spend a whole lot, much too much time in what has been called by Deborah Tannen the argument culture that we're sort of trapped in, that everything's cast as an either-or, right or wrong, kind of debate. And in fact, these issues are much more complex than that, and we need to have this ongoing discussion and dialogue in order to build some sort of consensus toward what the solutions might be. So it's not, express them in dollars or some other units. It's all good in a sense.
I have a PhD student who calls ecological economics the science of and. I think we should also talk a little bit, Bob, about the type of tools that are okay to use when the benefits are perceived. So when the benefits are fairly clear, it's clear what we want, then it is almost okay to put a total economic value on it. That's better than a total economic value means include both the direct and the indirect benefits, the direct and the indirect costs. Yeah, it's at least wider than we're currently doing in a cost-benefit analysis. So, okay, when the benefits are absolutely clear and we got a box around it, by all means, use total economic value or some cost-benefit analysis. But when the values and the benefits are not necessarily perceived and they're not clear, then they're not the right tools. Then we need different tools. And that then goes into the space of systems thinking, system dynamics, totally different tools that I probably haven't even thought of yet to address those questions. And it needs to be done in an adaptive capacity, because we don't really know what we don't know. So we need to train ourselves to not make policies in a linear way. If we pull this lever, then that will happen and that will be great. No, we need to also monitor how well did that go? Were there unintended consequences? How can we align it again to that vision? What else do we need to assess? What kind of tools do we need? And do it again and again. So it becomes a cyclical behavior. I know the councils have, you know, those follow-up type of plans, but we need to do that far more deliberate and have better tools to support those conversations.
Yeah, so we've got, can we get a show of hands of who else would like to ask questions? Heaps of people.
Yeah,
I don't know how we're going to prioritise this. Shall we take this question and then...
I've got the mic.
Okay. I'll leave it to Susan to organise this.
I'm Kathleen Ryan, and I'm currently reading Jonathan Porritt's book, The World We Made, which has a guy called Alex looking back from 2050 at what's happened between now and 2050. It's just come out, and it's quite interesting, quite stimulating, and it's got me thinking, flip, I don't think that's realistic, and other things where I think, wow, but it gives me hope for the future. And my question revolves around, how do you take conversations out from these kinds of circles to effectively engage a national community when the community is very polarised in terms of political ideologies? Because I'm not hearing about that. Robert, you said things seem to change overnight. Well, actually, those of us in the room, and there are a number of us who are involved in the peace movement, knew that on the surface things looked the same, but it took a lot of effort by a lot of Kiwis to get change in New Zealand's nuclear-free to a New Zealand nuclear-free policy. And I think if you look at change, it's about how do we get the dialogue effectively outside this room and into a much broader community than we usually do, because it seems to me most of the time we talk to one another but not more broadly. And in a sense, that's not a question on your particular speciality, but I think that's the way we will get what you want out there. And the other question...
There's the question there then, how do we broaden the conversation to other audiences or more people?
Yes, and how do we make the vision real? Because to be honest, the vision you gave me was earnest and important and significant, and it didn't move me.
Okay, there's a challenge. How do we make the vision more real? And
moving. Well, I think we need to involve Hollywood and some major, you know, Hollywood celebrities in order to really put that vision. And I'm not joking, actually. I think those kinds of things can really involve a much broader population. You know, name me one Hollywood movie that's based on a positive vision of the near-term future. I mean, they're all total dystopias or, you know, shoot 'em up action movies. And so, you know, if we could really get that sort of media involved in this sort of project, I think that could make a real difference in broadening out the conversation. And other sort of creative things like that. So if you know any of you are filmmakers or know any filmmakers or script writers or, you know, want to take Marianne's vision and maybe, you know, expand on it and take it in a different direction. But, you know, just having that conversation. The other way I think that might happen is through this process of scenario planning that Marianne mentioned. But that needs to go out to the general public. I think what they haven't done with scenario planning yet is to, get some actual public surveys of alternative plausible futures. You know, and there are, you know, so we could put those out to the public and have that discussion and get that involvement in thinking about what kind of world do we want and what are the trade-offs involved in different scenarios.
I also think that we children are very good at envisioning. They know exactly what they want, and they're not shy talking about it. But we kick that out of them very early on. And how often do we sit around and talk about the type of vision, the type of world we really would like to live into? Well, very shyly, maybe, you know, but we don't really talk about it very often. And maybe, you know, it needs something like mass media to get us in the habit again, being excited what that is, the future we're living into. I want to make one more point, though, and that's about worldview. Worldview, I think, is a very funny beast. And some research was recently done on climate change and how people, you know, see climate change. And that what they did is look at the Republicans and the Democrats as a basic worldview type, and how they perceived climate change. And then they aligned it with education. So a starting Democrat and a starting Republican fairly close together in how they perceived the relevance of climate change, yes? Then you give the Democrat education, and the concern about climate change goes up, right? Then you give the Republican education, and the concern about climate change actually goes down. So you get, based on the starting point of that worldview, the more information you give, the perception about the relevance of climate change actually widens. So there's something going on there that we need to understand better about worldview and where it comes from. And I actually think that we got a lot to learn from neurologists and psychiatry in that, in how people make decisions and what they can and cannot take in. Not everybody can process things in the same way. And if we think that we can just come up with a whole lot of information or examples or whatever, not necessarily so, is what I'm saying.
Okay, we have a question over here.
The Republicans need more treatment for their addiction.
Kia ora, my name is Chris McBride. I'm involved in arts projects and also a resident in the area. I'm interested in the idea of the Commonwealth, and I think that that means something different from, you know, what we normally sort of put those, we usually put it together as one word. But, you know, one of the things that when we're talking about what you've been talking about here at the present time is that the economics part of it comes first. I'm involved in an area which this part here, ecosystem services, are the benefits people derive from ecosystems. We're about to lose one of our greatest ecosystems amongst the Kauri tree, which will also lose, you know, another 20 further plants, bugs, all those sort of type of things, because we're not giving the type of support to that ecosystem to be able to be sustained. And we're not getting that support from government we're getting it from some local bodies and so on, but how do we actually make sure that this benefit, which we're talking about, and I'm talking about it in that more Commonwealth idea and not just purely from the economic sort of way. How do we change those values? And I think this is what the woman over here was talking about and Kepa was talking about as well.
I think that's what we've been talking about as well, so maybe next question.
Well, I guess the question, what I hear there is it something about the how? Is it... So what Robert, maybe Robert and Marianne, what you could talk to is specifically the how. You know, how do you actually take some of these concepts and tools you're talking about and apply them to the real world in a way that they do have meaningful outcomes and are picked up, say, in organisations like the council and so on, and applied?
Well, like I said, there are literally hundreds of examples we could talk about how this idea has been used in different contexts and in different places, you know, around the world. I don't know, maybe I should mention a business example, because I think that's kind of getting into the heart of the beast, if you will. And there's a company called TrueCost that tries to estimate the external environmental costs associated with business activities using fairly elaborate, you know, input-output models that look at the whole supply chain of companies. And they publish these results, and they're used in Newsweek to rank companies' real environmental performance, not what they say they're doing or their reputation, but what is the real cost they're imposing on society in terms of human health, in terms of loss of ecosystem services, et cetera. And there are a few companies that have really taken this on board. Puma is one of them, and several others who are beginning to do environmental profit and loss statements. If you could, you know, take that information and make it much more accessible to the public, I think that could change corporate behavior quite significantly and quite quickly. What are some other examples?
That's a return on investment. There's even an ecological restoration fund at the moment happening in Europe, where companies take a piece of their wealth and reinvest it in restoration. And what they want to see is not just ecological restoration, but also the social and cultural and human capital around it improved. So, but that's, again, I'm only so lukewarm on that one, because it's wealth and transferred to a major problem. But what I think is most appropriate for you is that you're talking about one species, one tree, right? And yeah, so exactly, but that's the point. So it's not about one tree necessarily, it's about an ecosystem. And when you look at it as an ecosystem, you also look at an ecosystem of people of different worldviews and how they connect. And so then you have to start to understand why people care about something, not just one tree, but an entire system. Right? And that's a dialogue. And those are things that can be mapped, as in cultural health, as in ecosystem health, as in there's all kinds of things that you can use to try and make that visible. And the sad part of it is indeed that cultural creative tipping point, when you get enough, especially unlike-minded people together, and they see the same thing, then there may be that tipping point happening. But we really have to think about it, yeah, in a systemic way.
Maybe I could add one other thing. I mean, I think the environmental community is as guilty, if not more guilty, of the environment versus the economy kind of framing, as the economists are. And I think that's exactly what we're trying to get beyond, is to say, you know, people are part of nature as well. We're not separate things. You know, we have to protect the environment just, you know, as a pretty picture, as this isolated thing. We're all connected with that environment. It's having impacts on us. We're having impact on it. You can't think of them as, you know, as separate and just go, you know, protect it as an isolated thing. I think that's the different framing that we're suggesting, yeah, will help us, you know, to change the game and to actually protect the environment in a much more significant way, because we recognize its connection with our well-being and the rest of the world.
Claire, I think we've just got one question from up here, Mayan.
Hi, I'm Marie Drury from Boulder Associates. We've done a little bit about the systems thinking, and the first question earlier on is, how do we incorporate ecosystem services into what the Auckland Council does? Some of you may have heard me speak at Natural Capital about the relationship between ecosystem services and the RMA. And that's what I think we need to focus on here. We need to help the Auckland Council work out how they incorporate ecosystem services into the RMA decisions. And there's ways in which they can do that. You can help people know about ecosystem services. They can think about it when they're looking at applications, when they're looking at AEs. They put on their ecosystem services glasses and they think, yes, this has measured the effects. Has the applicant asked the stakeholders what ecosystem services are going to be affected by this development? Have we considered the ecosystem services effects of their policies? And there's tools and instruments available, some of which we've already used in terms of qualitative assessments with stakeholders and multi-criteria analysis, where you ask people to value various ecosystem services that are going to be impacted by something or impacted by the policy, and you use that as part of your part two decision making. You help the decision makers through that process. So there are ways in which you can take this huge concept down into the place where the many council decision makers are sitting here today thinking, how can I do that? And there's the economic instruments and the qualitative non-economic instruments, which are of great benefit. And I'm sure council staff would pick them up and look at them and request similar processes with their things that they have, yeah, control over.
That's a good question. Thanks, Marie. I guess that's a question about, you know, how do you appropriately place value on these services? You know, what's the method? How do you determine a value for ecosystem services?
Okay, well, that's a long story. And there are many different techniques. I don't think we really have time to go into the details,
briefly.
But yeah. I think one of the easiest methods for people to understand is this idea of avoided cost. So, you know, that the New York water supply system, and this is a good example where they decided that it was much more cost effective to protect the watershed in order to supply fresh water to New York City than to build a very expensive treatment plant. The watershed could then avoid that cost. We did a study of storm protection value of wetlands in coastal systems, and showed by looking at data on storm tracks and damages in wetland areas, in the swath of the storms, we could statistically show the savings by protecting the coastal wetlands in terms of avoided storm damages, in the tens of billions of dollars per year. So in addition to all the other services that these wetlands provide. And that sort of thing, I think, had a very direct impact on decisions by, for example, the Corps of Engineers in Louisiana, who after Hurricane Katrina, they said, well, the solution here is just build a really big levee along the whole coast of Louisiana. That'll keep it from flooding. But once you start looking at it, you say, well, that levee, the built infrastructure, is going to be very expensive. It's going to start sinking immediately. It's really only going to protect against storms. The alternative is much more cost-effective use of our natural capital assets. So restore the coastal wetlands, which were degrading, divert the fresh water from the Mississippi back into the coastal wetlands and rebuild those wetlands. And I think several other communities around the world have taken that to heart with the impacts of tsunamis, for example, are much less when there's mangroves protecting the coast. So these are very, I think, straightforward, easy to understand kinds of examples. But you don't want to stop there. And I think, ultimately the techniques that we need to use need to be more sophisticated, more spatially explicit, more dynamic modeling kinds of things that could analyze all of the direct and indirect kinds of effects. We spend a lot of effort on economic modeling, which is certainly no more precise. If we spent that much effort on, sort of integrated ecological and economic modeling, I think we'd be able to show and document those kinds of impacts and values much more.
That's directly about designing with nature, really, isn't it? Much more.
Designing with nature, exactly.
Yeah. We've got time, as I understand it, for about two more questions. Sorry, folks. I know that a lot of you did have questions, and I understand. Those places are taken, right, Susan? Yeah. Yeah. So, but what I would say is that Marianne and Robert are they going to mill after this event? So, and they're very happy for you to come up and ask them questions in person and have a bit of a conversation. And so in the interest of keeping moving, we've got about five more minutes, time for two questions. And
you've touched on it briefly in the previous question, but there's been a lot of talk around communities and cities and councils. But I mean, I work in an organisation that has 400 odd staff and a factory. So my question is, how do we engage in the actual businesses that are making stuff and being productive and get them involved in nature capital? Because in my company, it's all about, the economic is important, you need to make money, there's capital investments each year to make the plant more productive and things. How do you try and incorporate nature capital into an organisation like that, especially when it's got quite a large number of staff and quite a few inputs from all over? Right.
Well, that's the true cost example that I was telling you about. And they have a recent report that just came out that looked at the the biggest external environmental costs across companies, but they can do this for all sort of listed companies, that's a way to get that information out there. And it turns out that it's quite complicated. There's no reason you would expect a company to understand all of their indirect impacts, on the ecosystem services of the world, because a lot of them are not what the company itself is doing, but what their suppliers are doing and what their suppliers' suppliers are doing, and so on down the supply chain. So, you have to have a fairly sophisticated analytical methodology behind that to really discover those hidden costs. But then you can make them more apparent. I mean, ultimately, you would like those prices to be reflected in the prices of the product, so that consumers could actually make decisions based on the true cost, the real, the real cost of these items, and not the fake cost that we're getting from our incomplete markets.
The challenge there is, of course, if you increase your cost because you're assuming natural capital, and then you can get it as done, then you're going to be
left. Sorry, I didn't quite get.
And then you can get it as done.
Well, yes. I mean, that's. that's certainly, you have to do it across the board.
I think, Marianne, you want to say something?
Yeah, I do want to say something about that, because I was on the advisory board, am on the advisory board of a hedge fund that does exactly that. It tries to distinguish the companies that do this well from a reputational perspective, because there are clear reputational aspects to it. I mean, in a Facebook era, almost anybody knows anything at any point in time. So there are clear reputational issues associated with doing this well or doing it not well. That go, yes, you can catch part of that in spreadsheets, but when it comes to investing in those companies, when it comes to attracting high-level talent, those people will actually look at how the reputation of a company. So it may well be that your company is a bit in the tail end of this, and I don't know how strong the competition is in that area, whether they will or will not have to make a change on this. The more competition, of course, the more of a run toward doing things well. But I think it is quite subtle in terms of management, and more so.
Okay, we've got time for one more question, I think, and then we're going to hand over to Jeff.
Hi, my name is Fiona Curran-Kernan, and I'm a soil scientist at Auckland Council. And so there's a lot of growth occurring in Auckland at the moment, and obviously I'm going to be advocating for soil values. But by protecting the soil values, would that may come at the cost of, you know, degrading a coastal environment? But the marine science said don't go there, so it might come at the cost of a freshwater body or else a heritage value or else cultural value. Is it realistically possible to protect all these environmental ecosystems to accommodate growth? Thank you.
Well, the first thing that comes to mind is growth of what? And then, what exactly are you trying to increase? And if we take the sort of narrow-minded GDP growth approach, I think that a lot of those things are not real improvements in our quality of life.
And population growth, yeah.
To grow people, and there's about 600,000 people expected to come into Auckland, and what to do with those people. So that at this point you have to make decisions whether you go do things more qualitatively better within the city limits or sprawl,
or spread out.
And what do you do with that impact? So at that point it really becomes a design issue. I mean, when I look at Auckland, I see a catchment. I mean, there's we can draw water from all kinds of areas around Auckland, or you can start thinking about using that water more efficiently, right? And you can start talking about producing food in a more urban type of way, which then also has an impact on the social capital. These urban gardens, for example, are not only productive there, they produce social capital. There's lots of human capital. How do we do this, resolve these issues better? I mean, there's so much more efficiency that you can gain in this space and do urban design better. And so just because it's an urban area doesn't mean it doesn't create ecosystem services. What I do want to say as a last thing, we do need to, the RMA issue and all that, it's really important that we start defining what we mean with ecosystem services, and that we then create almost a library of description of what it could mean, that we can take from, that we can use and apply on individual projects, both locally and regionally and nationally. They mean something different in those contexts, and we have to understand how we use that and how it connects between those different levels of governance. Otherwise, it will run out, and a great concept will run out in sand.
Okay, look, thank you. We've run out of time for Q&A. So I'm going to hand over now to Jeff Cooper, who is the Auckland Council's chief economist, and he's going to help us wrap up this conversation. Thank you very much.
Great, cheers. Thanks, Damon. It's a real privilege to be able to wrap this up. I feel somehow that I have a lot to answer for standing up here. I've just been sort of silently listening to everything in the corner there. And I won't try and give answers for all of those questions, but it is a great privilege to be here and listening to this debate, and I think a very important debate. And I'll just sort of wrap up this discussion. A couple of days ago, I noticed that Robert Shiller, who is a behavioural economist at Yale University in the United States, won the Nobel Prize, as I say, a few days ago. And to paraphrase Shiller, he says, behavioural economics is what people actually do rather than what the rational individual would do. And it may reassure a lot of us in this room, I suspect, that the study of what people are actually doing is an area of considerable growth in economics. Indeed, the emerging thinking in behavioural economics tells us a lot about the way people are acting in all sorts of areas. According to the Harvard Business Review, an article that was put out a few weeks ago, one of the most important insights in economics of behaviour is the way humans frequently adjust their behaviour based on the metrics that we're held against. Measurement will frequently impel a person to optimise their score based on that metric. And in many ways, I think we are what we measure. Give somebody some frequent flyer miles and they'll fly in all sorts of absurd ways to maximise the way that they can get those miles. So measurement matters, not just for getting us back on course, but it matters for establishing what course we are on in the first place. For government, measurement matters to the way we invest, to the way we regulate, to who we influence and to how we're influenced, all of which makes our measurement techniques so very important. But some things are easier to measure than others, meaning that the great playing field of measurement is not always equal. And the subject of today's Auckland conversation fits squarely into this category, I think. Costs and benefits associated with natural capital can be quite difficult to account for, and anybody that's done a cost-benefit analysis in this area will know that well. But it is important that we do. Marianne and Robert, your work has been exceedingly helpful. Marianne, we've had the privilege of working together on sustainable pathways too, but both of you, your work's been incredibly important for helping drive some of the thinking in this area, and I want to thank you for that and for this conversation. I think that these are clearly issues that need to be refined and adjusted as we go, and the leadership from you two is helpful in pushing us along and is well received. We have had some successes in this space though. Just last year, Auckland Council successfully argued to NZTA and to government officials that, for instance, long-term infrastructure should be evaluated over longer time periods. Indeed, you can't evaluate the full costs of natural capital if you're only looking over a 20-year time frame, and that's what we've been doing in New Zealand for the past few decades. Now that has changed to 40 years off the back of some of the work that people in this room have been doing. And likewise, the value of benefit that we're giving to generations further out has increased as well, and that's evident by the reduction in the discount rate from 8% to 6%. So these are really important changes, and I think pertinent to this discussion. So, you know, advocating for these sort of issues is one important thing that Auckland Council can do in this space. But of course, we can do a lot more than just advocate. We can institutionalise the measurement of costs and benefits when performing our cost-benefit analysis in accordance with things like the Treasury's Better Business Case guidelines. And we heard just a few weeks ago from the Chief Economist of Treasury, who outlined the living standard framework that the Treasury's put forward. And this document leaves plenty of room for those sorts of benefits to be included in our CBA analysis. And indeed, when we look further afield than that, we look at things like the Human Development Index or the Genuine Progress Indicators or the OECD Better Life Index, which I understand, which has just been put out, and I encourage you to go and have a look at that, that there are different ways that we are now measuring economic prosperity. And indeed, much more is being revealed on the state of how livability affects our economic prosperity. And this is just a few examples of how these outdated measurements are, you know, things are evolving in this space in a number of ways. And I think these sort of issues should be of great interest to economists and to planners and to environmental scientists and indeed the residents of Auckland, but also to local and central government. And I think, you know, in that context, I'd really like to thank you guys for coming along to lead this discussion, and I think there's obviously plenty more to be to be said after this discussion as well. I want to invite you all to have a drink at the box after this as well. I'll be there prepared to answer a few questions if you like, and also sort of bring to your attention the Sustainable City Showcase, which is down on the cloud from the 17th to the 19th. I also just want to thank the people that put this on, Ludo and his team that have put this on. It's no mean feat to put all these events on, so thank you very much. And I will leave it at that, other than saying thank you to our sponsors as well, who have been flicking down the bottom of this PowerPoint. So thanks very much, and I'll leave you at that.